Now listen to Paul. And he says, let every soul be subject unto the higher powers, for there's no power but of God. The powers that be are ordained of God. Now, you and I are to obey the laws of the land. Christians should be a law-abiding citizen. Now, you can't make me believe that you can carry on the violence and lawlessness of this present hour and still be a Jesus boy or girl. You are a Jesus freak if you take that position, and I mean a freak, my friend, because we are to be law-abiding folk, even when we think the law is unjust. Now, that's difficult for us to see, of course. We're to submit ourselves to the authorities for the very simple reason that they are ordained of God. Now, it's true that the kingdoms of this world belong to Satan, and injustice and corruption abound in all governments, and it is in our government today. Yet, in spite of all of that, God has control. History, I think, is the monotonous account of how a government flourished for a time in pomp and pride and then was brought to ruin and rubble. Why? Because that government went into lawlessness and that government went into corruption. And as it did, why, God brought it to an end. In other words, God still rules even over this world. I think that Emerson was wrong. He said, things are in the saddle and they ride mankind. Now, it looks that way. But God is not abdicated, and God is riding triumphantly in his own chariot, as we've seen today. And he's not disturbed about what's happening in this earth. He's not biting his fingernails today, wondering about little man and the governments he has down here. You'll recall that at the death of Uzziah, when the government seemed to be disintegrating, Uzziah had been a good king. And Isaiah, at that time, and he was discouraged. He was not unlike the ilk of mankind. He was very much discouraged. He thought things were going to the bow-wows. And he went into the temple, though, and that's a good place for a man to go, and especially in days like this, to come into God's presence. And he saw the Lord sitting upon a throne high and lifted up. In other words, God had not abdicated. Uzziah was dead, but God wasn't. God was still on the throne. Now, the allegiance of the Christian is to that throne, and his relationship to his government on earth is submission. That is it. And you can't escape it. I'm reading now verse 2 in my translation. So that anyone resisting the authority withstanding the ordinance of God, and those withstanding shall receive for themselves judgment. Now, the principle stated in verse 1 raises many questions, which the following verses amplify and explain, therefore. So here, the verse here seems to preclude the possibility of a believer having any part in a rebellion or revolution. What about it? Well, it's the example of Cromwell and Washington. Both of those men led a revolution, friends, but Stifler offers no solution. I'm not sure I'll have one, but I'm going to do the best I can. The believer has opposed bad government and supported good government on the theory that good government is the one ordained to God. The believer's for law and order as over against lawlessness. He's for honesty and justice as over against corruption and rank injustice. At great moments and crisis in history, and that's where we are today, the believer has some difficult decisions to make. And I want to just give you my viewpoint, and I believe that it will coincide with history. Now, in these last days, lawlessness abounds. The believer must be opposed to it, not be a part of it. Even when it's in his own government, we need to beware of those who would change our government under the guise of improving it. You remember John the Baptist, he was beheaded by Herod. Jesus was crucified under Pontius Pilate. James, the brother of John, was slain with the sword of Herod. And Paul was put to death by Nero. And yet Paul says here, whoso therefore resisteth the power, resisteth the ordinance of God. And they that resist shall receive to themselves damnation. Therefore, Christianity never became a movement to improve government or help society or clean up the town. The gospel was the power of God unto salvation of the individual. And Paul never went around telling about the bad condition of Roman jails. And he knew all about them from the inside, because about every town he went to, he ended up in the jail. And he knew a great deal about Roman jails, Roman prisons. I was in that Mamertine prison in Rome not long ago. And I got claustrophobia down there. I said to my wife, let's get out of here. Paul couldn't get out of there. They kept him down there damp. You remember he said to Timothy, he says, bring the cloak with you. He's getting cold down there. May I say to you, friends, that it's very difficult to say today that we're to obey a corrupt government. And I want to make this statement right now. I am not impressed today by these men who are running up the American flag and singing the national anthem and doing all of that just as a matter of promotion for themselves, whether it be a preacher or a politician. And yet, back of that is corruption. And there is corruption today in government. And I'll be very frank with you. I'm very resentful today, and I'm cynical of government. I have to be. Because when I hear of certain government officials and certain wealthy men in positions of power that didn't pay any taxes at all, and I'm retired now, and I got caught in a year when I retired, and I had to pay the taxes, and I never had a pension, and I had nothing to fall back on. And I actually, for 3 months after I paid my taxes, I had to scrounge around to get by. Now, that doesn't make me happy when I find out men in high places have managed not to pay taxes. I say to you, there's corruption today in government, all the way from the top to the bottom, and it's not confined to just one party. And these unsaved, these godless men that are in positions of government today, they do not understand, actually, the American system. You see, we were made a nation of laws by men who had a Bible background. Now, I don't think Thomas Jefferson was a Christian. He was a deist. But he had great respect for the Word of God. And many of those men were outstanding Christians. John Hancock was. He's the first name on the Declaration of Independence. He signed it. My friend, may I say to you that today we have corruption in government. And again, may I say to you that there's something radically wrong. I go into the civic centers of our cities today, and I see these fine buildings that cost millions of dollars, given out to contractors that are the friends of the politicians to build. And then I see these poverty sections today, and I hear both parties talking about a poverty program, and nothing's been done. Oh, corruption is there. What's wrong? Well, the thing's wrong is in the hearts of men. Now, what are we to do? Well, my business is to give out the Word of God, and my business is to obey the law. And I feel like that's what Paul is saying here. Listen to him. For Christianity is not a movement. I want to repeat it. To improve government or to help society clean up the town. It is to preach a gospel that's the power of God unto salvation, and it will bring into existence individuals like the man who signed the Declaration of Independence and gave us a government of laws. What's wrong today? Nothing wrong with our form of government. There's something wrong with the individuals that are in positions of power. One man, head of history department, University of Michigan, made the statement that America's in the hands of those who do not understand, actually, the spiritual heritage that we have.